chapter 19. And as we are continuing to understand the second to last section, but really the last major section in the Gospel of Luke, we're talking about the condemnation of the Son of Man for men. So now we're talking about the Passion Week of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, where we've already noted in the previous verses of chapter 19 of Jesus Christ riding into Jerusalem on the donkey in the triumphal procession, him weeping over the people of Jerusalem because of their lack of faith, and then also prophesying about the fifth cycle of divine discipline coming to the people and nation of Jerusalem with the city being wiped out and the temple being destroyed. And after that, then we see our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ now in verses really 45 through 48, where he then entered into the temple and he overturned the money-changing tables and also got rid of or cleaned or cleansed the temple of all of those who were selling and buying for the sacrifices inside of Jerusalem. So as Jesus Christ cleansed the temple, because it should be a house of prayer, not a house of merchandise that the people had made it into and the religious leaders had made it into, that Jesus Christ had to go and cleanse the temple. So now that we've noted that, we see in the last two verses of what we're going to note in verses 47 and 48, which are the last two verses of chapter 19. So I believe tonight I'm going to finish up chapter 19 and then we'll start chapter 20 on Sunday of this week. But in the last two verses, we see something else special about our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ that also sets up the next two chapters in the Gospel of Luke, because the next two chapters in the Gospel of Luke, 20 and 21, are in regard to the teachings of Jesus Christ, predominantly in the temple in Jerusalem, from that time period of Monday until about Wednesday, when he then was arrested and then going to the cross and suffering for our sins. So this is kind of within a two-day time period that we're going to see in the next two verses of the teachings of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. But these two verses kind of set that up and also tell us something special about our Lord that tells us a great principles how we should be conducting our lives as we witness the gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So specifically in verses 47 and 48, we see that Jesus Christ is teaching in the temple, especially in the face of adversity. So let's read the scriptures, and then we'll come back and get a little bit of detail associated with them. So as it says in verse 47, and he was teaching daily in the temple. But the chief priests and the scribes and the leading men among the people were trying to destroy him. And they could not find anything that they might do, for all the people were hanging upon his words. So as we've seen, especially in this section of the Gospel of Luke, Luke again is somewhat abbreviating the scenario, or I should say the scene that is going on right here. But basically, in a brief way, just saying he kept teaching in the face of the adversity of these individuals, and then they were also trying to look for a way to get rid of him and absolutely destroy him. So that's what we're going to be noting tonight, but recognizing that Jesus Christ kept facing even in the face of adversity, knowing that the Pharisees, the Sanhedrin, absolutely hated him at this time. They wanted to get rid of him. They wanted to destroy him. They wanted to kill him, as it were. But yet he kept preaching and teaching the gospel of himself, or the gospel of the kingdom of God, kept preaching the gospel so that even they could hopefully come to salvation. So let's look at verse 47. Let's get into the detail. It says, and he was teaching daily in the temple, but the chief priests and the scribes and the leading men among them were trying to destroy him. And the first thing we take away from that is that he taught daily in the temple, up until the time that he was arrested in the Garden of Gethsemane, that we'll be noting in the near future as we get into verses of the second half of 21 and then into chapter 22, I should say chapter 21 and then chapter 22, we'll start to see the arrest of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and then the various trials that he went through, culminating with the cross. And so Jesus Christ kept on teaching day in and day out, and probably even with a little bit more fervency, because he knew his days were numbered. And that's a great principle that we all should have in the heart of our soul, that even in the face of adversity, and knowing that our days are numbered, again, we all have a number of days. We don't know when the Lord is going to take us home. It could be tonight, could be 100 years from tonight. We don't know. But when the Lord does take us home, that is the end of our earthly ministry, where we have an opportunity to witness and for Jesus Christ, to evangelize those who are lost and dying, condemning themselves to the eternal lake of fire. This is our last opportunity to do so. And so with urgency and fervency, knowing that our days are numbered and our days are getting shorter each and every day, because again, every day you're another day closer either to your death or to the rapture of the church, and your time will run out here on planet Earth. And as I say, there's only two things that are assured in this life, and that's death and taxes, okay? And we already talked about the taxes this past week, how they were taxing the people and stuffing the prophets into their own pockets as religious leaders, and Jesus Christ dealt with that. Now he's dealing with his own death, where he's seeing the urgency of preaching the gospel so that all people could come to salvation, including the ones that wanted to destroy him. And so in these verses that I have up on the board in the Gospel of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, various verses in regard to Jesus Christ teaching daily inside the temple. And in John chapter 8, verse 2, it says, early in the morning, he came again into the temple, and all the people were coming to him, and he sat down and began to teach them. So what we're going to see also when we get to verse 48, but we see it here in the Gospel of John, all the people were coming to him. People wanted to hear the message that Jesus Christ had to teach and to preach each and every day. And they desired that message. So we do see a lot of positive volition in his day, even though we see the negative volition at the hands of the Pharisees and the Sadducees, the whole Sanhedrin. We see a lot of negative volition as they were rejecting him as their Messiah, their Savior, and as their King. We also see in Matthew 26:55, it says, at that time, Jesus said to the crowds, have you come out with swords and clubs to arrest me as you would against a robber? So again, as they arrested him in the Garden of Gethsemane, there was a lot of people around them at that time. He said, every day I used to sit in the temple teaching, and you did not seize me. And so Jesus Christ, once again, is saying, every day I was there in the temple. Every day you could have come and arrested me, but now you're coming in the cloak of night, as we talked about this past week, with that word for thieves or robbers. And they treated him as a common thief and a common robber, and they arrested him in the darkness of night. And they did it under the cloak or the shroud of darkness so that the people who were coming to Jesus Christ would not see it. And it's kind of interesting when things happen in the dark of the night. And even the Bible says nothing good happens after midnight or in the dark of the night. And we've even seen our own nation this past week doing things in the cloak of the night. So the people can't see it. The news can't see it. And you can't see who's being dropped off in your neighborhood. And you can't see what's being brought into your state, your town, your city, whatever the case may be. You don't know because it's happening under the cloak of darkness. Well, if it was such a good thing for all of us to have, why aren't they doing it in the brighter day? Why aren't they doing it in the light of day? Jesus Christ did all his teaching in the light of day because he was teaching the light. He was teaching the truth. He was teaching goodness and righteousness. He was teaching of hope and love and joy and peace. But yet the Pharisees, they had the complete opposite message, and they did theirs in the cloak of darkness. So Jesus Christ railed against them when they did come to arrest him. Why didn't you come in the day when everybody could see? Well, in our passage, and as we get into verse 48, I'll get into that a little bit more, but how they did it under the cloak of darkness because they did not want the people to see it. They didn't want them to know what they were doing because there were too many people that were following him. And if they tried to do it in the daytime, the people would have stood up and they would have defended against the evil that they were perpetrating. So they went and did it at night. But In any case, again, anytime people are functioning and operating at night in that vein, again, nothing but evil and unrighteousness is in view. So in regard to this, we see a couple of principles, and we see that this verse shows us the analogy once again when we compare that he just cleansed the temple and now he's teaching in the temple. We see the importance of our personal cleansing for our own ministry prior to teaching or preaching the Word of God, and we could even say learning the Word of God. And so what we see in this great imagery of this overall cleansing of the temple and then Jesus coming once the temple was cleansed and teaching there every day, the importance that we too need to make sure that our vessel is cleansed, our temple is cleansed before we get involved in preaching or teaching or even learning the Word of God. Because remember, Jesus Christ was teaching, but the people were learning. So we see the dual aspect of the cleansing that needs to happen before we enter into that. And as you know, and you should be very well aware of this, being part of our church, but maybe you're not. Maybe you're hearing this for the first time, or this is still a new doctrine to you. But in 1 John 1:9, we are mandated by God to confess our sins. And when we confess our sins, he is faithful and righteous to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And that's an experiential forgiveness, and it's experiential cleansing. Because at the day of our salvation, without confession of sin, just recognizing that we're a sinner and we need a Savior, we didn't have to name and cite our sins at that point. We just recognized that Jesus was our Savior and he died for our sins. At that point, we are positionally cleansed of our sins and we stand in that positional sanctification. We stand positionally holy and righteous in the eyes of God, given salvation that cannot be taken away. But after our salvation, as you know, we have a sin nature. We can continue to sin. And so therefore, if we do sin, how can we go and work with our God who is holy and righteous when we have sin upon our soul? We cannot. Even though positionally he has given us the credit of the forgiveness of those sins for salvation, how can we bring this sin bag to God full of sin and think that we have fellowship with him who is a holy and righteous God? And the answer is we cannot. But God in grace has done everything for us, and he simply says, confess your sins. As we see in the Psalms, as we see in the Proverbs, as we see in the book of Nehemiah, as we see in the books of the law, they confessed their sin to God. As we see in the sacrificial animals, they were confessing their sins to God. So confession of sin was there from day one in regard to the experiential sanctification that the people needed to have. And especially when we get involved in what? Preaching and teaching and learning the Word of God. And that's the image that Jesus Christ is doing here. Cleanse the temple, then I can preach, then you can learn. And once that all that is cleansed, now we can go forward in holiness and righteousness, and we can be effective in our preaching, in our teaching, and also in our learning, the intake, and then later on, the application of the Word of God. So 1 John 1:9 is an absolute necessity. And again, we talked to that one verse over and over and over again because it's right there in black and white for us in the New Testament. But as I've shown you before and have a whole doctrine, you can get it on the website, there are many, 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 many verses that speak to the confession of our sins, especially in the Old Testament, and then Jesus Christ himself in the Our Father prayer, as they call it, or the Lord's Prayer. Again, if we forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who have trespassed against us. Even in that template prayer, Jesus Christ brought up the point of confession of sin. So, in any case, this is important prior to teaching and learning the Word of God. And we only need to confess our sins if we have sinned since we last spoke with God. Yes, we give an opportunity before we start our services each and every time for a moment of silent prayer for you to confess your sin. But I always like to say, if necessary, because there's a group of people who used to believe in a confession of sin who have now gone off on the rails against that doctrine and against that teaching. And again, I think it's more opposition to their previous pastors that they have now rejected more than their knowledge of the Word of God and the application of it. But the sad fact of the reality, they are teaching against it and rejecting the doctrine. But yet we have it right there in black and white before us, and that we are to confess our sins, because without it we can't walk in the light, we can't walk in fellowship, and we certainly aren't filled with God the Holy Spirit. So 1 John is given to us along with many other scriptures that tell us that we need to confess our sins before we enter into teaching and preaching. And again, I give you an opportunity to confess your sin, and I say, if necessary. And the reason I say that is because I'm sure you all know it's only if necessary, but, you know, they were saying, well, you know, when I'd go to, when I'd have a moment of silent prayer and they'd tell me to confess my sins, I was just making stuff up to fill in the gap, okay? And I really wasn't, you know, just saying things that really I didn't do. Well, that's your problem, okay? That's not a problem with the doctrine. That's your problem in the understanding of the doctrine. But the Word of God says confess, so confess if you need to. And again, it even says, if we confess our sins, okay? But if we have confessed our sins prior, and again, let's say prior to coming to church tonight, and you come all the way to church and you haven't committed a sin since you walked in the door, you can sit down and want to have a moment of silent prayer. You don't have to say a word or thing. You don't have to think anything to God. Just sit there and say, 1, 2, 3, and wait for the moment of silent prayer to be over, and then we can all enter into prayer, okay, if that is a problem for you. But again, it's not a routine, it's not a ritual, it's not legalistic, and it's not something that we need to make up in regard to what sin I might have committed so I can just get something up there to make sure that I'm filled with the Holy Spirit, okay? No, wrong application of a right doctrine. And we have to do a right thing with the right way. And if you have committed a sin, confess that sin right away. Don't wait to come to church. Do it before, please, okay? But again, give you an opportunity if necessary. And if you haven't committed a sin and we enter into prayer or you enter into preaching or witnessing the gospel to somebody, whatever the case may be, just go right in because you're filled with Holy Spirit, you're in fellowship, and the Holy Spirit is working within you. Now you can learn, you can teach, you can preach, you can do it all because you are, again, in fellowship with God, walking the light, and also filled with God the Holy Spirit. But as it says, we are cleansed of all unrighteousness, which are the unknown sins, human good or evil that we might have committed. Because sometimes, especially the immature believer, they don't know what the whole category of sins are yet. So they might have done something not knowing that it's sinful. But yet, if they confess any known sins, they're cleansed of all unrighteousness, which means the things they knew about and the things they did not know about that are against the Word of God. That is the grace of God. And that's what we stand on, the grace of God. Not a system of works, lest any man should boast. So, number two is that we should be taking in the Word of God on a daily basis. That's the second principle that we find out from here. And again, not just on Sunday and not just on the Tuesday or Thursday nights that you come to church, okay, or are here online. Every day you should have some intake or in regard to the Word of God, whether it be reviewing the notes from our church or our service or going online and listening to it again or, you know, reviewing it or whatever the case, or even reading a good book in regard to a good Bible teaching, or even better yet, just read your Bible, okay? Just read your Bible, okay? Please read your Bible, okay? Everybody wants to read this book and that book, and very few people are reading their Bible these days. So, in any case, every day we should be taking in the Word of God as Jesus taught daily in the temple, because it is that important. You see, there's no more important thing that you can do in your life than have that time of fellowship with God when you are learning His Word. And when you are learning His Word, you are entered into a most intimate relationship with God, because it is the mind of Christ. It's the thinking of God. And if you want to enter into an intimate relationship with anybody, you have to know what's going on in their thought process, in their mind, how they think, how they function, how they operate. If you want to have a relationship with God, it's found in His Word. And so there's nothing more important than we can do in our day than to take in the Word of God in some form or some fashion. As we see in 2 Peter chapter 3:18, when we do, we grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And as a result, we are able to stand firm in the times of adversity. And again, Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10, 11, and then 13. I'm going to show you that in just a minute. In the face of adversity, We use the Word of God so that we can stand firm and not lose the ground that we have gained in our spiritual walk. And then also we see this in the book of Acts, chapter 17, in verses 10 and through 12. Let's turn to the book of Acts. Let's go to Acts chapter 17. Again, after the Gospel of John, the book of Acts, chapter 17. And as you're doing that, I'll show you on the board here, Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 through 11. And then verse 13, it says, "Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. Put on the full armor of God so that you will be able to stand firm against the schemes of the devil." How do you put on the full armor of God? You take in the Word of God, okay? You take in the Word of God. That's the armor of God. You don't just say, "God, give me your armor and let me suit up," okay? No, you take in his Word. That's the armor. And why do you do that? So that you can be able to stand firm against the schemes of the devil, the adversities that come in your life. And then it goes on to say that our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against Satan and the demonic forces, as I abbreviate that. But again, you can go and read the detail. But in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 13, it says, "Therefore, take up the full armor of God," which means knowing the Word of God in intimate detail, "so that you will be able to resist in the evil day, and having done everything, to stand firm." And that's what we need to do. And Jesus Christ stood firm in that temple, having cleansed it first, and then standing firm in the face of adversity, knowing that these individuals wanted to kill him and were already scheming as to how they were going to get rid of him. He still stood confidently, he stood firmly, and he taught the Word of God. You know, Jesus Christ could have ran at any moment at that point, knowing that these people wanted to kill him. He could have ran. He could have got out of town. He could have been safe. He could have lived off the rest of his life somewhere in Israel or somewhere else in the world. He could have had a great life, as it were. But no, he knew what was facing him. He knew why he had to come. He knew his days were numbered. He knew these people wanted to kill him, and yet he stood firm. And he taught the Word of God to the people, because that was the most important thing that he needed to do at that point in time. And so in regard to all of this, we see that there are three groups of individuals that were plotting together to come after Jesus Christ. And we've talked about all of these, in the past. But I just wanted to remind you of these three groups of the leadership of the Jewish religion of Jesus's day. And it's interesting when you go into the Greek, in the English, it puts all three of these together. And as it says, again, let's go back to, I'll get you an Acts, so you can just stay there. I'll just flip back. But in the English translation, it says, "But the chief priests and the scribes and the leading men among the people," and then it says, "were trying to destroy him." Yes, all three were trying to destroy him. But interestingly enough, when you look at it in the Greek sentence says the chief priest, which really is a word for high priest, okay, and the scribes, we'll talk about that in a minute, and then it says we're trying to destroy him. And then in the Greek it says and the leading men among the people. So it's kind of interesting how it put it that way. Because he puts the high priest and the scribes first, that they wanted to destroy him, and then the others were there as well. So basically, when we look at it, we look at the high priest or the chief priests and the scribes as being the more egregious offenders here in trying to destroy Jesus Christ, and then the leading men, again, being kind of an add-on at the end, just being complicit in what was going on. And so maybe the leading men weren't scheming with the Pharisees and the high priest to make all this happen, but they didn't raise a finger to stop it either. So they were complicit in the action and then kind of wholeheartedly went along with it. So it's kind of interesting when you look at it in the Greek, that's how it all shakes out. But the first group, again, as it says, the chief priests, and it's interesting that it's plural because you know there's only one high priest per year, but it's in the plural here, as it is many times within the Gospels. But we also recognize the whole storyline of Caiaphas and Annas. And they were father and son-in-law. And one was the high priest the previous year, the father. Now the son-in-law was the high priest in this year that Jesus was to be crucified. And when we go through the trials of Jesus Christ at the hands of the Jewish religious leaders, we see him going before Annas and then over to Caiaphas, or vice versa, okay? But again, going back and forth between those two individuals. And they're both called high priests. Well, one was, now one is. And it kind of just reminds you of a big mob, okay, in the mafia, and you get the father, the head of the family up there is the head of the mafia, and then you see the son running the business on a day-to-day basis, okay? That's kind of what was going on at this point in time. But those were the two individuals, again, in regard to the high priests that are in view here. Then we see the scribes, and we've talked about them, and they are the scholars of the law, as it were. Sometimes they are called the lawyers, okay? They would be the experts on the interpretation and an application of the law, and they would give that teaching to the people or help the Pharisees to make a decision in regard to some situation or whatever the case may be. They would also be the translators of the Hebrew Bible into other languages, like in the day of Jesus or after the Babylonian captivity, now translating it into Aramaic because the people stopped learning about Hebrew when they were in the Babylonian captivity. And they learned the Aramaic language and were living by it over the Hebrew language at that time. So the scribes were there to help out and do that. And then when we get down to the leading men, again, these were the more wealthy individuals that were part of the Jewish leadership and mostly predominantly of the religion of that day. Many times we could say these were probably the Sadducees, because the Pharisees of that day were more of the middle-class income people who took on the priestly responsibility. The Sadducees were the more wealthy individuals of the society and the position that they were able to hold within the Jewish leadership and council that is also called the Sanhedrin, okay? So when we see the high priest, the scribes, and the leading men, we basically could say the Sanhedrin, all that leadership of the Israelite religion and what was going on in Jerusalem at that time, and really the mob or the mafia of that day cloaked in religion, they were, again, conspiring against our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And he knew it, but yet he was not deterred. He did not run. He did not tuck his tail and say, oh, woe is me. No, he stood in the temple and he taught day in and day out. And so what we see that group of people trying to do was destroy Jesus Christ. And we have the word apolumi, which we've noted several times in the Gospel of Luke already, but it does mean to kill, to destroy, to ruin, and to put him to death. One of the few times that it's actually used in regard to Jesus Christ is our passage here in the Gospel of Luke. But you can also see that in Luke chapter 11, verse 53-54, Matthew 22, verse 15, and then in Luke chapter 20, verses 19 and 20. All right, let's go back to the book of Acts here. In Acts chapter 17, in verses 10 through 12, it says, in the brethren immediately sent Paul and Silas away by night to Berea. And when they arrived, they went into the synagogue of the Jews. Now these were more noble-minded than those in Thessalonica, for they received the word with great eagerness, examining the scriptures daily to see whether these things were so. And then as it says, many of them therefore believed, along with a number of prominent Greek women and men. So on Paul's missionary journeys, he went from Thessalonica down to Berea and taught the word there. And he went into the synagogue there, and again, the more noble-minded of the Jews in that synagogue. And they were more noble-minded. Why? Because they searched the scriptures daily. And that's the great credit that the Bereans have for all of eternity is found in the scriptures that will stand forever and ever and ever. That they were more noble-minded, and why? Because they search the scriptures daily. As Jesus Christ taught in the temple daily, We see these individuals seeking out the Word of God on a daily basis. And in regard to that, we see what we should be doing, going into the Word of God each and every day. And in fact, what's interesting, if you want to read the rest of the story there in the Gospel of Acts, that the Jews who were in Thessalonica, when they found out that Paul was down in Berea preaching to the Jews down there, the Jews in Thessalonica, who already ran him out of the city, now followed him down to Berea and started to stir up the crowd there and tried to bring harm to Paul in that region as well. So again, we see much persecution in the face of teaching the Word of God, even in this scenario. But the Bereans, they stood firm. And I love how it says, you know, those in the synagogue, because many of the synagogues that Paul went to on his missionary journeys rejected his word, and then he would turn to the Gentile peoples. Here we see the Bereans accepting his word because they searched the scriptures, they found the things to be true about Jesus Christ, and they believed, along with many of the prominent Greek women who were at the city as well. So Jew and Gentile came to faith as they search the scriptures daily. And that's what you and I need to do, is search the scriptures daily so that we recognize and understand the Word of God and then can apply it within our lives. We also see in Luke chapter 11, verses 53 and 54, where it says, "When he left there, the scribes and the Pharisees began to be very hostile and to question him closely on many subjects, plotting against him to catch him in something he might say." And in fact, this is early on in Jesus' ministry, as we've already studied and understood, that even back then they were trying to trip Jesus up. But back then, they were just trying to ruin his ministry. They were trying to deter the people from following him. So they were trying to point out, oh, he's teaching false doctrine, or he's a false prophet. And they tried and they tried and they tried to ruin his ministry, because they were jealous of his ministry. But even at that, they could not find a fault, because everything he said was absolute truth and righteousness. Now, as we get to the end of his ministry, then in Matthew 22:15, a parallel passage, "Then the Pharisees went and plotted together how they might trap him in what he said." You see, at this point, the entrapment was not just to have a derogatory sense towards his ministry and to destroy the ministry of Jesus Christ. Now it was to get him, to kill him, to get rid of him, and absolutely abolish him, and try to do that first on their own, but if not, then turn him over to the Romans so that they could kill him, because the Romans did not allow the Jews to have capital punishment, even though it was according to their law. The Jews did not allow it as their occupiers. But the Pharisees tried not just to destroy his ministry, but now to destroy him, and with that, destroy his ministry. But yet Jesus Christ stood firm in the face of all this adversity, in the face of them trying to kill him, trying to plot against him, trying to entrap him, everything that they were doing, trying to trip him up and to falsify him, or get him to do something so that they could kill him off. Jesus Christ stood the test of all that adversity, and he kept on teaching. And in this era of adversity that we are beginning to go through as a people and as a nation, and as Christianity becomes more and more hostile in regard to the world's view of it and treatment towards Christians, okay? As the world gets more hostile towards you, the Christian, you've got to also stand with courage and fervency so that you don't cower and run away and preach and teach the gospel of Jesus Christ. Because if we don't, who's going to? And there's nothing more important. And even if they can take your life through martyrdom or various forms of persecution or whatever the case may be, does it really matter? And again, yeah, you may suffer a little bit in that persecution, but guess what? You get to go home and be with the Lord. So hallelujah, even better. But the fact of the matter is, God has a plan for us. He knows the numbers of our days. And as our days are numbered, we should have more and more fervency each and every day, even in the face of adversity and persecution, as Christians in our world today. And maybe it's going to get worse. Maybe it's not going to get worse in the near future. Only time will tell. But whatever that future is, continue to stand firm in the knowledge of Jesus Christ and keep preaching and teaching the word. And as we now turn to verse 48, it says, "And they could not find anything that he might do." And then it goes on to say, "For all the people were hanging on to every word he said." So his righteousness and his teaching actually foiled their attempts to try to accuse him of any wrongdoing. And that's the great part of it. Again, if you stick to the word of God and don't try gimmicks and don't try your own human ways to convince people of the gospel or the truth or, you know, that Christianity is the right way to go, don't use any gimmicks, okay? You don't have to add anything to the story. Just stick to the script, as it were. Stick to the Bible. Stick to the truth. And then live your life like the Bible. Live your life like the truth. And then you too will be blameless in the eyes of your accusers. That's what I'm looking for. Lost it there for a minute, okay? In the eyes of your accusers, your condemners, another way to say that, okay? But again, stand firm and don't give them an inch. And continue to preach and continue to teach. And if you stick with the word of God and apply that word in your life each and every day, you will shut them up, because there will be nothing that they can bring against you because you have been following the word of God and because you're teaching the word of God. And the only thing they could then do is just say they hate you for hatred's sake, or they don't like you for dislike's sake, and make things up and falsify, and then they get involved in all kinds of sin against you. And if that's the case, vengeance is mine, says the Lord. Leave it in their hands. Absolutely leave it in their hands. It's interesting, in a situation that I've recently been in and involved in, and what the case, I won't go into a lot of detail about it, but, you know, you've been accused as a crazy Christian. And, fire and brimstone type of teacher and this, that, and the other thing. All kinds of accusations about how I teach and what this Christianity is all about. Really, Christianity in general, with a lot of derogatory statements trying to do what? Ruin the reputation. And that's what it's all about. Ruin the reputation for their own means and for their own gains. But you know what? They will not be successful. They destroyed Jesus Christ, and he rebuilt it in 3 days. And they're the ones who actually got destroyed in the end. So basically, you don't have to worry about it. Again, if they destroy you, again, physically, you'll be rebuilt in a blink of an eye as you get, you know, ascend into heaven and then receive the resurrection body at the appropriate time. Again, the interim body and then the final resurrection body. Again, in the blink of an eye, it's going to happen. And you will receive new life and that resurrection and live for all of eternity. And they will be the ones that have to suffer as a result. And you don't need to lift a finger. And also, you don't need to worry about it. You don't need to worry about it, because you let God deal with it. You stick with the truth. You stick with holiness. You stick with righteousness. And let God deal with the details after that. And even in the face of adversity, stand firm and keep preaching and teaching the word of God. And because Jesus Christ had no sin of his own, they could not justify their desired aggression against him. All the accusations, they could not justify anything. And I love the first part of it. They could not find anything that they might do. We want to get rid of this guy. How do we do it? You can remember that they were also trying to do what? Be under the disguise of the law to maintain their holiness and righteousness and keep their uppity, legalistic, self-righteous, arrogant mentality of their soul going. So they were trying to do it. And they were trying to find and connive and scheme some way to get rid of Jesus Christ. And they could not find a way. And even when they did arrest him, again, they brought two witnesses in front of the trial, and the two witnesses, you know, basically falsified and misapplied what Jesus Christ said. And the only thing they could come up with is that he would destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days. Best thing they could come up with. But Jesus wasn't talking about the temple of God. He was talking about himself. which they absolutely did not understand. So, again, they could find nothing to accuse him. He had no sin of his own. Even Pilate said, I've got nothing. I've got nothing on this guy, and therefore I'm washing my hands. And if you want him, it's up to you. And I'll give you Barabbas or I'll give you Jesus. We'll take Barabbas. Crucify Jesus. And again, the whole analogy of the scapegoat was portrayed right before their eyes. Right before their eyes, and they didn't even see it. But Jesus, even in that scenario, preached the word of God. He preached the gospel. When he was arrested and Barabbas was set free, the gospel was being preached. Because that's the whole scenario of the scapegoat. And so again, as you go through life and you teach and preach the word of God and live your life unto God, the gospel will be preached. And you don't even have to say a word. Jesus didn't say a word when he was up there at the praetorium, you know, at the courtroom before the Jews who were, saying, crucify, crucify, crucify. Didn't say a word. And yet he preached the gospel by his actions. And God the Father put the whole thing together because God the Father's got a plan, and he's got a plan for you too. You just need to walk in it and follow it each and every day. So this shows us also the height of the hypocrisy in their souls. And again, if you are operating in holiness and righteousness and operating in truth, and those others are accusing you as a result, it shows their height of hypocrisy. And it's funny, you know, those who are calling me crazy, hate to say it, but they're the ones who probably are crazy, okay? And they've got the issue. They've got the problem. And we see that in our day as well. What they call, you know, they accuse one side of being evil, but yet they're the ones who are doing all the evil in the cover of darkness. And then they call themselves good, and they're the ones who are actually perpetrating the evil, the sin, and the wickedness. It's amazing. But it's the height of hypocrisy. And the hypocrite loves to accuse the individual of the exact same sins that they are committing. And didn't we see that with the robbers analogy on Tuesday and Sunday? They called Jesus a common thief. He's a robber. He's a thief. They treated him that way too. But yeah, they're the ones who are stealing from the people and from the temple treasury, filling their own coffers. So they love to accuse in the height of hypocrisy. Unfortunately, they rejected him, but they could find no fault in him. They did not receive him as their Messiah, their Savior, as their King. So instead, you know, they saw him as somebody that was just trying to take over their authority and their little fiefdom, as it were, their little kingdom that they had built up for themselves, and they did not want to recognize him for the person that he truly was. So they wanted to get rid of him and kill him, absolutely destroy him and get him out of the way so they could go on in their merry little world, being under the fifth cycle of discipline, under the Roman occupation. Isn't that great? Okay? You see, and that's the sad part of it. They didn't care about the Romans, you know, over them, although they had, you know, they hated the Romans and all that and this and that and the other thing, okay? But they cared more about their own power and authority and money and maintaining that and having to and to kill off Jesus so they could hold on to those things and suck up to the Romans than being under the Roman authority that they currently are under. And again, as we talked under the fifth cycle of divine discipline, that's cowardice. Okay, it's a hypocrisy to the heights, and it also shows no national pride because they were more concerned with their own wealth and power than they were about the people and the nation and truly their relationship with God. But yet, as we see in the second half of this, for all the people were hanging on to every word he said. And so it doesn't say it so clearly here, but in the other Gospels as well, the reason that the Pharisees did not move on him at this point is because all the people that were listening to him. It was kind of a double-edged sword. They were very mad and angry that the people were listening and following him and, you know, keep coming to him day after day, and very mad and angry that he kept teaching the truth of the word and they couldn't find anything wrong with it, okay, as hard as they tried. And those scribes were the experts of the law, but even Jesus confounded them and got them all twisted up in their shorts, and they couldn't know how to respond to the truth of the word because they were misapplying it as well. So again, they just accused, they accused, they accused, but all falsely. They got mad at him, but they also couldn't move against him because all the people were around him, and they didn't want the people to see it. Because if the people saw what they were doing, the people would have been outraged at that time. So they did it under the cloak of darkness. They came in the Garden of Gethsemane in the middle of the night. They did all their trials in the evening, which also is against the law, because even God says nothing good happens after midnight, okay? Nothing happens in the darkness, okay? But yet they did it. And then even their own scribes objected to it and said, wait a minute, we're doing this wrong because we did it at night. We've got to do it in the daytime. So I think at the crack of dawn, they had one more little trial. Then he was off to Pilate and Herod and all that. But at that point, now the Jewish people, he wasn't in the temple anymore. He wasn't before the people in the temple where the Sanhedrin would operate from. Now he's in the Roman sector. He's before Pilate, and then he goes over to Herod, back and forth, as you know. And then it's off to crucifixion by 9 a.m. in the morning. So again, because all the people, and they had to do it under the cloak of darkness because they weren't operating in the light. They weren't operating in the truth. And again, if you have to operate in the darkness to hide from other people, right then and there you know it's wrong. Right then and there you know that you're not doing a right thing in a right way. But Jesus Christ was. He was teaching the truth. He was teaching the truth in the Word. And it was contrary to the narrow viewpoint and perspective that they had of the cosmic viewpoint that is Satan's viewpoint. And that's the whole point. When you have a narrow vision and a narrow focus of what you think is right, and it's steeped in Satan's cosmic viewpoint rather than divine viewpoint, then you know it's all wrong. And what you're going to see is that the truth that is taught is always counter or contrary to whatever that narrow focus of teaching is found inside of Satan's cosmic system. And divine viewpoint is broad, it is wide, it is bright, it is light. It's not afraid of the light, it is not afraid of the darkness. It is shown day in and day out, day and night. And if you are operating in truth, you've got nothing to hide. But unfortunately, when you operate in lie, deception, and falsery, again, then you need covering. Then you need something to cover up with. Then you need the darkness to operate in so that the people don't see what you're doing. And unfortunately, you know, you can maybe hide from the people, but you can't hide from God, okay? Because God is light. And all things that are of life and of this world are always in the eyes of God. He doesn't miss a thing. He doesn't miss a thing. And God will deal with all the evil in the world one day, one way or another. So, yet those with the positive volition, as we saw in this crowd that were coming to Jesus day in and day out, what were they? They were amazed at his word. The Pharisees, the Sadducees, they wanted to kill him, get him out of town. We don't want to hear from this guy. Destroy his ministry, destroy him. So it destroys his ministry. But yet the people were amazed at his word. And as Luke says, they were hanging on every word. They just wanted to hear more after more after more. And those individuals who have positive volition towards the word of God always want to hear more. Those who have negative volition towards the word of God don't really want to hear it, don't really care about it. And maybe they just want to do their little churchy thing and, you know, come once in a while and, you know, leave the next day and live life or sleep in or whatever they want to do, okay? And got to go here, got to go there. This is more important. That's more important. They're not positive towards the Word of God. Those who are positive towards the Word of God can't wait to hear the next message. And again, those who are here tonight and those online as well who are consistent in your intake, again, I commend you for wanting to hear the next thing, hear the next message. What does the next part of the Word of God have to say? What does the Holy Spirit have for me today? Those are the Berean type of individuals who are more noble-minded. But those who really don't care about the Word of God, they are negative towards the Word of God. And unfortunately, you know, a cosmic viewpoint has crept in to cloud their mind with the scar tissue that is now building up upon their soul. So the ones who are positive are amazed at the Word of God. They hang on every word. And as Mark says, the whole crowd was astonished at his teaching. Again, they were just amazed. They couldn't wait to hear more of the Word of God. And they came day in and day out, even early in the morning as Jesus entered into the temple. And so the people that Jesus was preaching and teaching to, they were the oppressed ones, both by their religion and now by their government as well, the Roman occupation. These people were absolutely oppressed. They had no hope. They had no social standing. But yet they were able to do what? Hear the Word of God. And hear the encouragement of the Word of God, hear the hope of the Word of God, and hear the joy and peace and happiness and the promises that are found in the Word of God as they were encouraged with the good news of the gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. You see, those who were oppressed couldn't wait to hear the next word. And unfortunately, I believe our nation is going to have to get to that point, because right now our people aren't oppressed. They have wealth and health and everything at their beck and call. And unfortunately, it's the oppressed people that usually turn to God because they've got nothing else to turn to. But when we have our health and wealth to turn to, you know, we look to that as our God, and we don't need God, and everything's okay in my life. But when the adversity or the oppression sets in, then there is a hunger and a desire. And I hope our nation doesn't have to go through that, because I don't want to see our nation go through that type of adversity or that type of future form of oppression. I hope it does not happen. And it doesn't need to happen. We can have a revival at any point, but we need to preach and teach even in the light of adversity. And pray to God that there is a turn or a revival within our country and within our nation. But at the time of Jesus, they were oppressed, both from their religion and from their government. And they turned to Jesus Christ because he had the good news of the gospel. And so therefore, the principles we take away is that we too need to be courageous and bold in the face of adversity and keep preaching, keep teaching. And if they want to come and, you know, break down the door and drag us out of here, so be it. We're going to continue to show up until that day happens, until they absolutely physically stop us from preaching and teaching the word. And even if they do that, we'll do it in the jail cells. We'll do it in the prisons, wherever they put us. We'll do it at the gallows, if that's what it takes. Again, keep preaching and teaching the word with courage and boldness, regardless of the adversity. And unfortunately, we're such a soft society today. If somebody looks at us cross-eyed, oh, you're talking about Jesus? Okay. How can you be teaching on Jesus? That's offending me. Stop talking about Jesus. You're the bad person. Okay, I'm sorry. I won't do it anymore. Is the society we're in today. But that's a society that's doomed in regard to its client nation status. But the society that has bold Christians who are willing to stand up and preach and teach the Word of God, that's a society that's going to have a revival. That's a society that's going to come out from the oppression and ultimately have freedom and liberty once again as God blesses that people and that nation. A couple of things will be done. In 2 Timothy 4:2, as Paul was teaching the young pastor Timothy, preach the word, be ready in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with great patience and instruction. And that's what we do. See, sometimes the Word of God's in season. People want to hear it. And I hate to say it, but, you know, between kind of now and Christmas, we're going to have more people at church than we have before. Then after Christmas, it's going to wane off. Then they'll have a little bit of revival, maybe in the late spring. And then in the summer, we don't have that many people. Then in the fall, we get it again, okay? As people prepare, and it's kind of weird, too, the 20 years we've been doing this, is like just before Christmas starts to drop off again. So weird, okay? But that is what we know as being in season. There are times when the Word of God is in season, and everybody wants to hear it. But then there are times when it's out of season, when nobody wants to hear it. Do we stop? No. We continue to preach and teach, and we reprove, we rebuke, we exhort with great patience and instruction. And just keep going. Keep going and keep going. And never stop. Keep preaching and teaching the word each and every day. And as we see the remedy to arrogance or selfish ambition, as we see in the Pharisees, the blindness and the ignorance, the bitterness that leads them to revenge motivation, the only way that that is defeated is how? Through the Word of God. Through the Word of God. And keep preaching and teaching and living the Word of God, and those things can be rectified because they will be shown the evil within their own heart. And God will bring about a way to turn the evil into dust. God will find a way if we keep faithful in preaching and teaching His Word. Because again, the light always overcomes the darkness. Again, the light always overcomes the darkness. And then finally, what we learn from this is that receive the teaching of Christ in times of peace so that you are prepared to maintain His peace in the times of the storms. And just to get that in real quick, during these 2-3 day period where Jesus was teaching in the temple, it was the time of peace. Okay? Then the storm was about to come. He was about to be arrested. The whole city is going to be turned upheaval. The disciples are going to run. They're going to freak out. They lost their leader. He's getting crucified. He's getting killed. He's buried. They're not even sure if he's going to get resurrected. It's all in an upheaval and an uproar. How are you going to deal in the time of the storm if you don't build up your soul in the time of peace? So again, a good lesson for all of us from this is teach and preach and learn in the time of peace so that when the storm comes, you have all the information to maintain the peace that God wants you to have in your soul. But if you don't build up in the time of peace, you're not going to have it in the time of storm. So if you're healthy and things are going well for you right now, double down on the intake of the Word of Doctrine, of the Word of God, Bible doctrine. Double down on it now. Fill up your soul, because there will be a time where there's an adversity that comes into your life and you won't be able to scramble and flip through the pages of the Word of God at that point. You need to have it up here. And if you have it up here, you'll be fine and you'll weather the storm and you'll persevere. You'll stand firm because you have put on the full armor of God. So do it in the time of peace and take advantage of those peaceful times. Don't go and lay out at the beach and think that, you know, it's all going to be, you know, sunshine and rainbows for the rest of your life. In the time of peace, take in that word so you're prepared for the time of adversity. All right, so we'll close. Father, we thank you for this time. We thank you for your word. We thank you for the great lessons that you've given us in this 19th chapter in the Gospel of Luke. And we ask that these things continue to resonate within our soul, Father, as we apply them and glorify you more and more each and every day. So, Father, we thank you for this time, and we ask for your travel blessings on our way home. In Christ's name, amen.